Jay Gracie. That sounds groovy. But I'm afraid I don't have anything classy enough to wear for such a grand occasion.
Hello, and welcome to TCM Slumberground, the pre-show party for TCM Underground, which airs every Friday night, late night, on Turner Classic Movies. My name is Millie DeCherico. I'm the programmer for TCM Underground. And as always, I am joined by my esteemed TCM colleagues, Matthew, Ben, and this episode's guest, TCM writer, researcher, and fact checker, Jeff Stafford. For this episode, we are stepping right up to the 60s psychotronic classic, She Freak, written by David F. Friedman and directed by Byron Maid. Matthew, as always, could you please give us a synopsis of the film?
I can. So She Freak stars Claire Brennan as Jade, a bored waitress working in a roadside cafe who's offered the opportunity for another waitressing gig with a traveling carnival. Once she starts working at the carnival in search of a better life, which is debatable, she befriends Moon, played by Lynn Courtney, one of the carnival attractions, and falls in with Steve St. John, the man who owns the carnival. And from there, she gets mixed up in an affair with Blackie, one of the carnival workers. Things just sort of get out of hand and escalate, and Jade makes several enemies at the carnival and on her way to the top, ultimately leading to some pretty severe consequences.
Of course, as cult movie fans, you probably have heard of David F. Friedman. He is a big name in the exploitation world and also, interestingly enough, tied to the carnival business. Ben, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about him.
Like you said, he's a big name in the exploitation genre, which promised audiences lots of sex, lots of gore, and lots of violence because they didn't have to go through the production code and go through distributors. And he was a big name in that. He kind of got his start in the 50s with a company that did production for films like Mom and Dad, which showed a live birth and was a big thing. People came just to see nudity. And so then in the late 50s, he met up with Herschel Gordon Lewis and they started making nudie cutie movies, which were basically movies that were made at nudist colonies in Florida, where they'd go and shoot couples frolicking around and playing volleyball or something like that. And, you know, I mean, this was a big deal at the time because you couldn't see that kind of images on in mainstream movies. So then after people started getting kind of bored with the nudie cutie films, they moved on to start making gore films. Movies like Blood Feast, 2000 Maniacs, and Color Me Blood Red. He went on to keep making films like this, and I think that's how he kind of wound up in the genre of She Freaks.
Jeff, I want to point to you for this because I feel like you have a lot of institutional knowledge about the link between the carnival world and the cult movie world.
When I was growing up, the carnivals were, you know, everybody went to them, but there were a lot of things you would see at the carnival that you would not see anywhere else, certainly not in a professional circus like Ringling Brothers. I mean, the sideshow attractions, you know, there were burlesque shows. The carnival stuff, of course, in the 60s had some problems with being able to show what was actually seen in movies like Freaks because there were laws against it. And in the case of She Freak, which was shot in California, Friedman wanted to, you know, use human oddities, but there was a law in California and Florida against the exploitation of people of that sort. So he had to create his own freaks for this movie with the aid of his makeup artist.
That's one of the most interesting things to me about She Freak is that it seems upfront like it's going to be this like very salacious film. And then when you turn it on, you realize, oh, there's just, it's almost kind of like a French New Wave film. There's a lot of characters walking around to music and it's atmospheric in this way. And it just shows a lot of the behind the scenes of the carnival. I feel like there might've been like a high era of the carnival film almost. I mean, I know we had a Nightmare Alley remake recently, but I feel like She Freak actually fits into like a larger tradition.
It's really the beginnings of seeing carnivals more as horror. I think in the 60s, you do have something like Freaks, from the 30s that kind of begins that trend, but it's not until the 60s, late 60s, early 70s that you start getting these films where carnival life is really portrayed like a horror show. For example, the same year that this came out, a British film called Berserk came out starring Joan Crawford, and it's got a lot of the same elements. It's, it is more of like a slasher, but it is a lot of B-roll of the carnival. Most of the runtime is just animals doing dances and watching Joan just walk around and pretend to tame tigers. I just think it sort of speaks to the type of entertainment that was still kind of almost like drive-ins at that time. Like, and they would start to kind of die out on into the 70s. And I think you can really see that with something like The Fun House, which came out in the early 80s, where it paints carnivals as just these really scary places where if you're a teenager, you're going to go and you're just never going to come back because somebody's going to kill you on that ride. And so I think that there's this sort of switch over in the 60s where they go from being more wholesome to something that's like a lot more sinister.
It's also like just the world of the carnival is like by its nature, it's like they're kind of like nomads and outsiders. They're kind of like these rebel type characters. So like, it's always kind of fascinating.
She Freak is kind of interesting because it follows a trend of when the carnival that it was actually filmed at, which was part of West Coast Shows, which was like this group that would, tour it up and down the West Coast. I think by like the mid to late 70s, that company was just defunct because nobody really was coming to the carnival anymore. So it kind of trends along with the sort of the films and how they sort of died out after the 60s.
That's the part of the movie I love so much, is half of it is almost a documentary. You could just watch it and just see them setting up the booths, the tents, then you see them working the customers. I mean, and they're real carnival people. I mean, they're not actors, and you know that watching it, and it's great to see that.
Yeah, I love some of the principal characters in the film. Of course, there's Claire Brennan, who has this like great kind of Southern drawl. She kind of in this weird way kind of reminds me of like a Sissy Spacek type. She's just kind of like a Texan lady who's a little no nonsense. And apparently Ben noticed that a company called Sassy Pants provided her wardrobe for the film.
Which she owned the stores. Like, it was a store that she owned. Who wouldn't promote that your wardrobe came from there? I loved her character too, because right off the bat, like if you're a character who starts off a movie by like telling your boss to take this job and shove it, then I'm on your side. But then she turns into like a horrible person who is mean to human oddities. She kind of does a heel turn halfway through the movie, but I was really sold and I didn't want to give up on her.
I often wonder if the term she freak is just simply that she's a woman who takes no shit and she wants to live life on her own terms. And maybe in that era, that was a little not the thing to do, right?
The guy who plays Blackie was actually not an actor. He was an airline pilot. And he just kind of did this for fun. Shout out to Blackie. He had my favorite room in the back of that trailer with his name spray painted on it.
The decor was bananas in that room. Very much apropos for his character. And he's kind of a hunk. He has that like hunk moment where he takes his shirt off and he's like backs to the camera and he's just sort of like, yeah, you ain't going back to Steve St. James.
The man who owns the Human Oddities Pavilion is Bill McKinney, and he had a pretty long career in films. This is his first film. He looks very clean cut in this, but he is the mountain man who raped Ned Beatty in Deliverance. He had a pretty long career, and he worked for Clint Eastwood after that in like five movies. It's kind of interesting to see him in this first film where he's the good guy. Basically, he's the romantic interest.
The one thing that I will say about rewatching She Freak now is that there was a restoration that was done on the film by the American Genre Film Archive in Austin. And they basically are taking a lot of the old Something Weird library. They are kind of doing, really cool restorations and putting a lot of this stuff out on Blu-ray. And I have to say, the first time I saw She Freak, it was on like a ninth generation dubbed VHS tape. I had always seen this movie in the 90s in kind of bad SD quality. It's amazing how we're in an era now where you can see the sweat dripping off of people's faces in She Freak, and there, you can actually see flies. There's a fly in one of the scenes that's on the counter, like behind one of the characters. And I'm like, I would have never noticed that fly in the 90s. I think it's to the credit of places like AGFA and just sort of general interest in preserving the Something Weird Library after Mike Graney, the owner of Something Weird, passed away. Were you guys fans of Something Weird? Like, am I alone in that? I basically poured over their library, and it was really kind of my entry point into cult film.
Yeah, same. It was like film school when I found that out. And they covered all the genres, so it really was just like a textbook of what exploitation films were.
It was formative for me, for sure. And it was kind of this whole era of Something Weird Video, Psychotronic Magazine, and I mean, definitely pre-internet. We were in a pre-internet world trying to find cult films. And you know, I think it's interesting too that, you know, David Freeman actually contacted Mike Graney at some point and said, hey, I have all these films, you know, would you like to distribute them? And the Friedman films were kind of the building blocks of the original library, where, you know, basically Something Weird was the first time I ever saw Blood Feast and, you know, Color Me Blood Red, all the Herschel Gordon Lewis stuff. There was just so many classic, you know, titles in that library. And I'm just glad that there are people preserving it, like AGFA. I know that Mike Graney's widow, Lisa Petrucci, is heavily involved. Frank Hedenlauter, the director of Basket Case, I know he's got his own kind of like line within the library. I think it's great that's still continuing.
Yeah, I mean, like speaking of the restoration and the work they do, it's so great, because when I was watching this, I was reminded, like, there's a shot where they're kissing and the Ferris wheel is turning around and you see the lights, and I'm like, it's such a great shot. It's really beautiful. Yes, these guys were kind of hucksters and like showbiz men who were out to make a buck. Just by the very nature of filmmaking, you're photographing a carnival, you're telling a story, so there's art to it, and so it's great. Even if you're out there just trying to like fill seats and sell the sizzle and not the steak, it's great to see that kind of artistry that just comes through.
Friedman himself, in the audio commentary, he was the one who shot some of that point of view footage from the Ferris wheel, the Scrambler, and some of those rides, which is do it yourself, you know.
I almost got sick when you said Scrambler. So,
so Jeff, I'm going to call you out for a second, because you were actually working at TCM at the very beginning of TCM Underground. And I distinctly remember having a meeting with you and Eric Weber, who was one of the original creators of Underground. And we were coming up with film titles, and it was a grand old time in 2006. But also, I love that you actually worked on Monster Vision, the original Joe Bob Briggs show on TNT. And I was wondering if maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
Oh, sure. When I started full-time at TNT, they had just signed Joe Bob Briggs to Monster Vision. He had been on the Movie Channel, and that's where he had his show for a couple of years. And the TNT programmers, Lisa Mattis and Phil Oppenheim, snatched him up for Monster Vision. And, you know, the shows always seem kind of loose and almost improvised.
Hey, Joe Bob Briggs here to tell you that Friday nights this summer on TNT, we've got stuff that's scarier than my second ex-wife when she forgets to take her medication.
He was a really hard worker. He was very professional. Off camera, he would work on those scripts the night before, sometimes changing things at the last minute. You know, Joe Bob was with the network for 4 years.
It's kind of cool. I don't know. I like that you've been in the game for a long time.
On the fringes.
Yeah, that show and like just kind of cable shows like that were so great at putting a spotlight on the world of cult movies that were kind of different and kind of made you realize that there was something special about them. And I love that TCM Underground keeps doing that for us.
Yeah, TCM Underground was definitely influenced by that pre-internet world where you had to find out about movies from TV. Okay, so it's now time for the roundtable question, as we do on every episode of TCM Slumberground. For this episode, I'm going to ask our panel, what is the most fun / terrifying carnival experience that you've ever had? Starting with Matthew.
I'm going to go away from fun and terrifying and just say grossest. I feel like that would be appropriate for this.
Sure.
Yes, yes.
So when I was younger, I went to a carnival with my cousin, and we got on this ride that was one of those two-person swings that goes really fast. And my cousin had eaten a bunch before we got on it. And as we went up, he started saying, oh, I don't feel very good right now. And so I said, oh, okay. I wish you'd told me this before we were like in the air. So we get in the air, it starts spinning and it starts going faster and faster and faster. And then finally I look over and he just gives me that look like all that food's coming up. And it did. And it went everywhere. It went on me. It went on people down below. The guy operating the ride was just laughing so hysterically. And I was like, stop the ride. But he wouldn't. He just let it happen. And my cousin was sick for like an entire day after that. So don't eat a bunch of food and go on a carnival ride.
I don't really have like a horrifying experience, but one that was kind of like traumatic for me as a young teen was getting to ride in Panama City at the Miracle Strip. There was like some ride called like the Himalayan something. And it was basically a car that you sat in that went around in a circle and went up and down and it slung you over like to the side and with super great force. And they do this while they were blasting like Van Halen or Bob Seger, some kind of like classic rock tune. And like, although like kids who were there drinking and smoking were like rocking out to it. And it was like heaven on earth, like for the few minutes that I got away from my parents. That was kind of my best carnival amusement park experience.
Van Halen going at 60 miles an hour. What about you, Jeff?
I think the most fun carnival experience I had was the exhibit that it was a fake human oddities exhibit of a woman turning into a gorilla. And you go into a tent, standing room, no seats. There's a woman in there dressed in a leopard skin bodysuit. And the announcer of the booth is saying, you know, she's going to revert to her primeval state. She's going to become a gorilla, and they start lowering the lights. The lights get really dim. They start playing Iron Butterflies and a guy will beat up. And it gets pretty dark. And what happens is, you really couldn't see this very easily, but this glass panel comes down and she's behind it. And they start to reflect the changes, her getting hairier on the panel. She's behind it and she slips away and a guy in a gorilla suit comes and takes her place. And so this is all real low lights. And the first time I saw it, I saw the show twice that night.
Unbelievable. Well, when I was in college, I went to this very problematic tourist trap in the South called South of the Border. And they had a little parking lot carnival. Again, they said it was a theme park. I thought, no, there's six rides here tops, it's not a theme park. And none of the rides were on and there was nobody around, but I saw that they had a Ferris wheel and I thought, I want to go on the Ferris wheel, right? So they actually had to get a guy that was working at the diner across the street to come run across the street and turn on the Ferris wheel for me. And it was the most terrifying ride I have ever been on in my entire life. Like, don't want to see somebody that was just flipping hamburgers come on and turn this ride that I'm now being suspended in midair. And the other five rides that they had were just as terrifying. And I don't know why I asked somebody to come turn them on. I guess I really wanted to ride them just to feel like I had been there. But I don't suggest it. Make sure the rides are on when you get there. And that is all for this episode of TCM Slumberground. I want to thank the esteemed TCM colleagues, Matthew, Ben, and Jeff Stafford. Thank you so much for being on this episode. You did great.
It was an honor, and I'm not worthy.
No, we're truly not worthy. You are my hero. And if you're interested in watching more episodes of TCM Slumberground, head over to the TCM YouTube channel. We have a playlist there. We've got a lot of episodes in the bank at this point. So if you want to binge watch us, you feel free to do so. And if you're on Twitter, we're over at TCM Underground. Until next time, thank you so much for watching. Bye. Step right up, folks, and witness the horror of a man who can age 50 years in a matter of seconds. And make your way to this tent where you'll see a man who turns into a cat.